everybody, this might look like a rerun, but it's not. I am just going over the different things that we're using in this series of three videos. This is number two, and we're using items that you see on screen to do different resist techniques. Today's episode or video is going to have, we're using these canvases for all of them, but we're going to be using that contact paper to try and resist or create a mask or however you want to say it. So let's get started. I've got my contact paper here. I actually cut a piece the size of a canvas that we're going to be using, but I wanted to show you that you could use masking tape for this. You could use any kind of sticky tape, paper. It would work. It's the same concept. I'm showing you here that you could use the masking tape to do the same image, the cross, but what I didn't like was those sharp, harsh edges, because there's a third technique that you'll see in our next video when that one shows up, that is, it's going to look almost exactly like that. So I didn't want the same look. What I really wanted for this particular piece was more rounded, softer cross points. So we're going to use contact paper. So the first thing I did was cut a piece the size of the canvas that we're using, and then tape it down to my surface so that way I could use the grid. Another reason why I like this contact paper, I could use the grid as my guide and a ballpoint pen and a pair of scissors. That's what you need for this. So I used the grid as a guide to kind of figure out what size I wanted it to be and make it symmetrical. And I want, like I was saying already, I wanted it to be kind of rounded. So you see, it's a sort of a real slight arch that I created there. And then because those lines on the paper, I'm able to make it, you know, down at the bottom. And then, and so you see me just sort of fiddling this out. I mean, you can see what I'm doing here. So just watch me stumble through trying to figure out how do I want to do this. So how many squares down and how many over, and we'll make the last piece like, does it match that other one? Yeah, close enough. Okay, good. So then I just connected them. And I wasn't exactly sure, like, how far into the middle did I want these to go? Like, I want it to have this roundness to it, but to still be across. So hopefully you see it's coming out. But you notice there on that one that I went in much further than I did on the left side. So I correct it with a few lines, but it doesn't matter. This is the beauty of this. So the purpose of these three videos was to focus on resist techniques and it with acrylics. And when I'm doing mixed media art, I'm always trying to find easier and more impactful ways of creating layers. And resisting is something that I felt like, this resist technique is something that I found by accident years ago when I first started mixed media journey. And I loved putting paper down, like gluing paper down, but the medium that I would glue the paper down with would sometimes make it so that I couldn't then color the paper. So then I used it like through a stencil, and I loved the technique that it created with that. It was really cool. And I have some paintings I keep wanting to work on that have that from back in those days. And I think I was actually going to work on those that this day that I started doing these videos. And I thought, you know what, let's experiment with this concept of resist techniques. And that's where these three videos sort of came out of. And if I didn't say this before in the first video, which, by the way, if you haven't seen the first video, there's a link in the description or the iCard that will take you to the other videos in this series if they are up and posted. But I did them all at the same time. So even though you're seeing one canvas from start to finish, I actually didn't do them like that. I did them in stages. And so for me, it was quite an experimental day, but being able to capture it all on video and go back one actual canvas at a time is pretty cool. So the one thing I do want to say about this part of the technique is that you want to start in the middle of the contact paper and push out to the edges. That'll get you great adhesion to the canvas. And I wanted you to see it's an open canvas. It's not a canvas panel. So you're actually able to stick that stuff right onto that canvas. It's pre-gessoed from the factory. I didn't do any gessoing on my own, but it works really, really well-ish. And I don't want to give any spoilers. You'll see. All right, so here we have just some of the different inks that the acrylics that I was going to use for all three of these projects. So I'm showing some colors you're not going to see in this particular piece, but I did want to show you. It was, Liquitex inks, FW inks, some fluid acrylics, some fluid acrylic in a fine liner pen mixed with like airbrush medium. I also used the iridescent gold and the coppers and different things like that, but most of it was either liquid acrylic inks or fluid acrylics, or I made my own with the airbrush medium and put into a fine liner pen. So anyway, you get the idea. All right, so let's go ahead and get started with this, right? It's about time. So I knew my color scheme for this particular. I did this for all three of them. I had a color scheme already in mind for what I wanted each of these canvases to represent color-wise, and I knew that turquoise blue was going to be the gist of this one. And I didn't even know where to start. I was kind of nervous because I didn't know how this contact paper, how the edges of the contact paper were going to react to the moisture of the paints. And I like to spray my paints, all that. So how was it going to work? So I just sort of went for it, and I put some of the I think it was turquoise. Isn't that amazing? Oh, I get speechless when that indigo just spreads out like that. Okay, anyway, so so I'm just mixing between fluid acrylics and high flow, and the difference of the way that they react to each other is just awesome. And I'm trying to concentrate around the edges of the cross that you can barely see on there, right? So my focus is wherever the plastic is from the contact paper. I'm just trying to make sure that I get that edge covered so that when we take the plastic off, we should have a sharp edge of the cross. But I mean, I might as well tell you, it doesn't work that way. If you already saw the picture at the beginning, you know that's not the way it's going to end up. So, and we'll talk about that. So I can already see. I was pointing to it there a little bit. I can already see it started to seep under. That indigo was just too fluid for the contact paper to really resist, it. But it gets worse actually, so it doesn't matter. But this is the fun part about experimenting, right? Is that we try to figure out will my idea work, and if it doesn't, then what are we going to do with it? And that's been my journey with the Kraaft Shaak since day one. I've never really known what in the world I was doing, but I've learned a whole lot because I just let go and do it. So again, just trying to stay around those edges of that cross and make sure that we get everything covered. I don't want to get rid of it. Right about here, I start telling myself, don't get rid of the white space. Like, the white space is really awesome. I'm liking that we're not painting the whole canvas. I'm really liking that, so I don't want to ruin it. I like how you have those wicking acrylic paint wicking moments where it just sort of spreads out and it looks like spider webs almost on the edges, splashes. Right now, I'm thinking baptism. I'm thinking, I don't know, I just love this. And here's where it all goes wrong. I mean, I say that, but it's not really terribly wrong. But I'm not speeding this up because I want you to see this happen. Boom. Oh, yeah, it's plastic. Heat and plastic, you know, don't work. Did you know that? It's all about the experimentation. So I basically, with my heat tool there, I ruined any chance of ever having a sharp edge around the cross because I just released it from, I basically shrunk the plastic, is what I did. And in doing that, I'm telling myself the whole time I'm drying it, I'm like, well, let's see. We could go set this outside and let the sun dry the paint and have nothing else to do for an hour. Or we could just keep going with it and say, this particular experiment is probably not going to work as we had planned, but what are we going to do to fix it? And that's exactly what I did. I just didn't think twice about it and said, oh well, keep moving. More shrinkage is going to happen to that plastic. It's coming up there at the top now. We don't care. I mean, at this point in time, it's like, forget about it. I just want to get to making this piece now. I'm so excited by what the blues have done already that I just don't even care. And I guess what the point that I'm trying to get at is that even though with the first two pieces, if you watch the first video, you already know this, it didn't work out as I planned either, but it still ended up gorgeous. This one I actually like more than the last piece you saw, if you did watch that video. And I'm saying that because you should go watch that video if you have not yet. But this is the one, this is my number two favorite. Number one favorite I saved for last. So when that one gets posted, you can check that one out. And if it is already posted, it's probably a link in the description already, so you have to check it out. Anyway, so I'm just sort of like, what are we going to do with that? It comes up, but it's not off. Like, well, let's just go with it. Let's just take it off and see what we got. Well, it turns out it didn't really resist all of that paint anyway. Even before I had, messed with it with the heat tool, it had already seeped under. So now I'm looking at it and thinking it really does look like water. That's all I'm thinking of. And, I'm just sort of meditating a little bit about what I'm seeing here, and that it looks almost like you can tell there's a cross there, but it's not obvious. It's like there's a sign. And that will be where the message comes in at the end. So while I was playing with this, I'm thinking, okay, well, let's try to define it more so it's a little bit more obvious. And we use this ballpoint pen to draw these lines in. And I don't know if you saw, but I sort of drew on my table there, on my protective paper, and then got it wet to see if it would smear, and it didn't. So, okay, it's waterproof, so we won't ruin things if this doesn't work out. And it's just really not very bold. And before I lose the thoughts that I'm having as I'm looking at this piece, I just wanted to go ahead and put the words on it right now. And so I do, and it says, I will set a sign among them. And I just kind of felt like that really was fitting with this piece. And this actually, when I say that I had done all three of these canvases in the same day and at the same time, it went like this, this, I think this one was actually the last. So I did them in stages. So I put the resist part on all three canvases. Then I went to the very first one I could work on was this piece. So in real time, on the day of creating these, I had already put on the resist for the canvas that you saw in the previous video, and the resist on what will be the third canvas. And then I took this canvas, put the cross on it, and then started painting. So this is actually the first painting, actual painting stuff that I had done for this day. So I'd kind of just sort of getting started, getting warmed up, basically. And I'm a little intimidated because in truth, I kind of wanted to leave this piece alone when I got to this stage. Like put the words on it and be done. But then I still felt like that's just not obvious enough. I want that sign to be more obvious, the cross. And so I thought, well, we'll outline it with white. And yeah, it's looking a little better. But it's just not enough, I feel like. So, okay, we'll write some scribbly words here and there, and the white into that blue just looks really cool. That's awesome. It's still not enough. So, splashes. Yeah, when it's not enough, add some splashes. Still not enough. It doesn't matter. So I'm like, all right, let's look at a little bit more. What else are we going to do? And I just realized, you know what it needs? It needs contrast. But look at that shimmer there for a second. Oh, that's so good. But it needs some contrast. So really, that's what the problem is. The white is not popping on that cross because there's not enough contrast. And I thought that I could use this copper, that's what I just showed you, the copper Liquitex acrylic ink, as sort of a, put some contrast here and there, and then it'll stand out a little bit more, but it doesn't quite work that way. And this acrylic ink has a different property than, say, like the blue or even the turquoise metallic that you see up in the left corner. It's different because it's almost like there's no paint in it, or no pigment in it. It's almost like it's just the minerals of metallics, because it's either copper or watered down copper. It's not like a more liquid version of copper. Do you see what I'm saying? In the run that is happening up there, right up there, it doesn't have paint in it. It just has sort of mineral droplets. So it's like watered down copper. So I thought, okay, then I'll put more. Because if this isn't working, then more will work, right? And then I realize that's too much, so then you gotta wipe it up. And I spray it, and it's very strange to me how it's just not behaving like paint. It's just the metallic properties of this copper. Very interesting to me. So I thought that this would add some contrast, and I'm dangerously close to feeling like I may have ruined something here, but you can wipe up and sort of fix just about any problem, really, as long as you do it quickly. So I'm sort of cleaning those spots up so it's not as obnoxious. And when you lay it flat, you can see more now. It's much more transparent and much more almost non-existent. And as it dries, it's even less because the water, I'm telling you, there's just no pigment in it. It's the metallic properties. So I thought, okay, so that didn't work for what I was meaning when I said contrast, right? So I decided that I would grab this charcoal pencil, and it's a soft charcoal, so it's just blends real easy with my finger, and put in some black lines, some darkness in there, that then when I go over it with the white fine liner again, it will stand up and pop off of it a little bit better. And I almost went in with the charcoal pencil or the charcoal block there and put it around the edges, and I talked myself out of it. And I'm so glad I did, because I really wanted it to have this contrast that you're seeing happen there. And I only did it like on a shadow underneath. So it's not on all sides, it's only on what would be like the right side, as if the light is coming from the left. And then now, when we put the fine liner over the top of this, pow, it's going to pop right off. Look at that. So with that copper, and that copper mixed with blue, by the way, great combo. Love that. But then that copper and the charcoal has now just created this really great contrast, that this white just pops right off of it. Bam. Now you see the sign, right? Few little marks just to make it look a little scribbly. And we're done. So this one is absolutely my favorite so far. We've done two publicly. You'll see the third one when it comes out. If you're watching this way in the future, it's already available to you. You don't even have to wait. But for those of you watching it on the day of its release, sorry, you're going to have to wait another week. But check them out. Thanks for watching. Have a crafty day, everybody. Bye-bye.